said, wonderful Wednesday. We are getting ready for our wonderful Wednesday Bible study. Amen, amen, amen. Aren't you just glad to be able to study God's Word? You know, it's a blessing to be able to get into the Word of God and to find out what God wants us to do and to find out what all of this that we're doing in this world is all about. Because you know what? It's all about Jesus. Ain't got nothing to do with us. And sometimes we think it's all about us. But God created this world so that we might give him the praise, the honor, and the glory. And you know what? We were designed, we were created to give God glory. Amen. We always try and, you know, get accolades for ourselves. But you know what? God is the kind of God that he loves us so much that he don't mind sharing a little bit of his glory with us. That's how good he is. You know, I just love the Lord tonight. I just love him. I love him. I love him. And I don't know about you. I don't mind just spending some time just learning a little bit more about him. So that's what we come to do tonight. We come together. And you know, I'm so glad to see you out there in Zoom land and Facebook Live and on the conference call. It's just so wonderful just to be able to connect with everybody. And you know what? We thought that we would not be able to have such a wonderful time because we were not able to go to 2525 West Church Street. But I'm finding out that even with all of the things that are going on with our social distancing, that we can still connect up together.
Amen.
You know, I still feel the love. I still feel the agreement, the connectivity in the body of Christ. And that means that we're united in the Spirit of God. And so I'm just so thankful tonight to be able to once again prepare my heart and your hearts and our hearts together. As we know, Pastor's going to come and he's going to teach us from the Word of God. And tonight he's going to talk about some bad girls in the Bible. Some bad girls who become good girls. Amen. So I'm excited to hear the Word and find out about these bad girls and becoming good girls. Amen, 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 amen. So let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we thank you tonight for just allowing us to come together one more time. Father, you are so good to us. Lord God, you've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. Oh God, it was you who woke us up this morning, started us on our way, allowed us to have breath in our bodies, movement in our limbs. Oh God, we thank you, God, that you woke us in our right mind, God. We thank you, Lord God, that we was able to look around, God, and see our family, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that we can give you the glory tonight, that we can give you the praise tonight. We thank you, Lord God, that we can count on you. Lord, there's nobody like you. You're sovereign. There is no one in this entire universe like you. Lord, we thank you because you are our creator. And we thank you made us in your image and in your likeness. So we come tonight, God, to learn a little bit more about you. Open up our hearts, God, and just open up our spiritual eyes, God, so that we can hear, God, and we can see, God, what you're saying to us individually and collectively. Lord, we thank you, God, for all that you've always done for us and all that you've yet to do. For I declare that eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, all that you have in store for us, for those who love you, the called according to your purpose. So, Lord God, we give you glory tonight, God, and we thank you, Lord God, for what you are about to impart into our spirits. Let us, Lord God, not just be hearers, but doers of your word. This we ask in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, amen. If you would turn in your Bibles tonight, we're coming from the book of Joshua. Joshua chapter 2, and I'm going to be reading the entirety of that chapter. Amen. So if you'll just follow along, and I'm reading from my New King James Version tonight. New King James Version. So if you have a different version, it may read a little bit differently, but it's still the same word of God. It says, "Now Joshua the son of Nun sent out two men from Acacia Grove to spy secretly, saying, 'Go view the land, especially Jericho.' So they went. And they came to the house of a harlot named Rahab and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, 'Behold, men have come here tonight from the children of Israel to search out the country.' So the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, 'Bring out the men who have come to you, who have entered your house, for they have come to search out all the country.' Then the woman took the two men and hid them. So she said, 'Yes, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from. And it happened as the gate was being shut, when it was dark, that the men went out. Where the men went, I do not know. Pursue them quickly, for you may overtake them.' But she had brought them up to the roof and hidden them with the stalks of flax, which she laid in order on the roof. Then the men pursued them by the road to the Jordans, to the fords. And as soon as those who pursued them had gone out, they shut the gate. Now before they lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, 'I know that the Lord has given you the land, that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon as we heard these things, our hearts melted. Neither did there remain any more courage in anyone because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God, in heaven above and on earth beneath. Now therefore I beg you, swear to me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness, that you also will show kindness to my father's house, and give me a true token, and spare my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all that they have, and deliver our lives from death.' So the men answered her, 'Our lives for yours. If none of you tell this business of ours, and it shall be when the Lord has given us the land, that we will deal kindly and truly with you.' Then she let them down by a rope through the window, for her house was on the city wall. She dwelt on the wall, and she said to them, 'Get to the mountain, lest the pursuers meet you. Hide there 3 days until the pursuers have returned. Afterwards, you may go your way.' So the men said to her, 'We will be blameless on this oath of yours, which you have made us swear, unless when we come into the land, you bind this line, a scarlet cord, in the window through which you let us down, and unless you bring your father, your mother, your brothers, and all your father's household to your own home. So it shall be that whoever goes outside the doors of your house into the street, his blood shall be on his own head, and he will be guiltless. And whoever is with you in the house, his blood shall be on our head, if a hand is laid on him. And if you tell this business of ours, then we will be free from your oath, which you made us swear.' Then she said, 'According to your words, so be it.' She sent them away, and they departed, and she bound the scarlet cord in the window. They departed and went to the mountains, stayed there 3 days until the pursuers returned. The pursuers sought them all along the way, but did not find them. So the two men returned, descended from the mountain, crossed over, And they came to Joshua, the son of Nun. They told him all that had befallen them. And they said to Joshua, "Truly the Lord has delivered all the land into our hands. For indeed, all the inhabitants of the country are faint-hearted because of us." I read the entirety of the second chapter of Joshua. May the Lord add a blessing unto the readers, but more abundantly to the doers of his most holy word. Amen. We got to be more than just a hearer of the word. We got to do what it says do. Amen. Amen. So we just thankful to God tonight for what he is about to do. And we know that God has a word for us. And we know that God is going to get us prepared for what lies ahead. You know, we don't always know what lies ahead of us, but God knows. And he knows why he's given us this word. And just like that harlot in Jericho, she was like, "I know God is up to something. I may not know what it is, but he up to something." So God up to something. Amen. So we turn the hands of Pastor Crutcher. Amen. 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 Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Greetings, brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for being on the line tonight. And thank you for just tuning in to our Bible study. Want to get into the word and just let the blessings of the Lord be with us. Amen. Let me say a prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word. And we ask, oh God, that you just use what you created, and Father God, and speak to what you made. Then God, help us to be receptive to what you say, obedient to what you will, and just thankful for what you've done. In Jesus' name, let us say amen.
Amen.
Amen. As let's give Reverend Crutcher a hand for doing a good job of just opening us up and getting us ready. And in the spirit of the Lord, amen. Get the fire of the Lord moving. We're so thankful. We're coming tonight from the book of Joshua, second chapter that was read. And we want to talk about when bad girls go good. This is an amazing story that has always amazed me, because it demonstrates the love of God and God's ability to transform our lives. It also demonstrates and let people know, no matter where you started from, it's not where you started, it's you wind up in God.
My God.
And if you go to God, God can take all the things of your life and God can bring you into his relationship, no matter who you were. And so we want to talk about some bad girls in the Bible that went good. And I want to highlight one named Rahab. And in doing so, I want to just touch bases for a moment. When you look at the Gospels, Matthew is the first recorded gospel, and when you look at Matthew, he begins his gospel with the genealogy of Jesus. And when you hear genealogists talking about the bloodline, God is a God that deals with the blood, and it's the bloodline that leads to Christ. And so it is that bloodline that comes to Christ that goes all the way back to Abraham. It begins with Abraham and goes through 42 generations all the way to Christ. And you can go in the Bible and trace those 42 generations. And what you will find is the Bible will follow the bloodline. And whoever's in the family that's going to be the person that's leading the bloodline to Christ, that's the person the Bible will follow. And so because the word is trying to get to Christ. So that we find here in this genealogy, if when you look in the genealogy, you'll find that there are five women listed in the genealogy. And normally women are not listed a lot in genealogies in the Bible. But there are five women in that genealogy. And all five of them, one of them gonna surprise you now when I get to one, at some point in their life was considered a bad girl for one reason or another. And there are different reasons why people are considered bad girls. Some, and so I don't want to talk that. Some do that through actions of desperation. Some through actions of lifestyle choices. Some through actions of lustful moments. Some through actions of association. And some through actions of righteous obedience. Yes, you can sometimes be considered bad because you did what was good and what was right. And so, and as we go through that, but however you get there, however that labor get on you, or whatever it is, I want you to understand that your mistakes and your past circumstance does not have to be your legacy. Because there is a God. There's a God, first of all, who's a forgiving God. And the truth of the matter, if God weren't forgiving, none of us could be saved. For the Bible said, all have come short, have sinned, and come short of the glory. So when we talk about folk doing wrong, that's all of us. And he had to forgive all of us. And so, but he's a God of forgiveness and restoration. That's what I like about him. He don't just forgive you and leave you where you are. He can forgive you and bring you into a whole new life, a whole new legacy, a whole new dynamics of how you look at life, and help people see you even in a different way. And all of these bad girls went on to become good mothers and save their families. My God. And just because you've got some stuff in your past don't mean that God can't use you. And it doesn't mean that God don't want to use you. Now, people may not want to, but God wants to. And I love to tell, I love to tell folk, you ought to just don't mind being God billboard. And when people think that because of your past, you should not be serving or doing this, you tell them that I'm just an example of grace. That's all you see here. I'm God walking billboard. Yeah. And when they remind you of what you used to be, tell them, go, yeah, but look at me now and look what God has done for me now. And that's what we have to be, God here. So we have this, the one I want to focus on is Rahab. And Rahab was was a prostitute. The Bible said harlot in most cases, and we like to use that word harlot because that we like to dress up stuff. And harlot sounds a little better. But when you say, but the reality was she was a prostitute. And the funny part was she was a prostitute in the wicked city of Jericho. Jericho was so wicked that God allowed it, told them to destroy the whole thing and told them don't take anything out of there. Just destroy everything. Brought the walls down. Supernatural power of God brought the wall down and told the Israelite, go in there and just destroy everything. Don't keep anything. But it's an amazing thing that I find. When you look at the story of Jericho, the only thing that survived, the only house that made it was in the prostitute house. Lord have mercy. Yeah. You wouldn't think that it was at the priest house, at least at the temple, but it was at the prostitute house where deliverance was found in Jericho. And that lets me know that God can save you anywhere. And folk always talking about where God won't go. And if God see one of his children somewhere, God will go get you. Yeah, all you got to do is be willing to come on out with it. Yeah, now if he go in there and get you, I advise you not to stay. And I know he will go get you because he came and got me. See, that's why I don't have to ask some things. I don't have to ask Peter and Paul and John and David and all those folks. Some things I can tell for myself. I've got a testimony because I know where he came and found me. And it sure was not in the church house. Praise be to the Lord. But I'm so glad to be where I am now. Thank you, Lord. And in order to make that shift in life, there's some things that you have to learn to do. And we want to talk about some things that Rahab did that made a difference in her life. And the first thing I want to talk about is Rahab learned to speak the heart of God. And in order to speak the heart of God, you got to seek him. You got to think about and be concerned about to know what God is up to. Now, Rahab was not an Israelite. And she was not a part of Abraham's family. And she was in the land, and here they are, it was in the land of Canaan, in the place where God told them to kill all these folk. Yeah, she was in the land of Canaan, the Canaanite, and in the worst city there, because Jericho was the stronghold of the land of Canaan. And it was right, that was the first place they had to go to, this stronghold called Jericho with fortified walls. It was said that you could drive a chariot on the top of the walls around the city. It was strong and fortified, a stronghold. And the enemy loved to build strongholds right in the place where you got to go to get the promises of God. See, they were going into the promised land to get the promises of God. And so Jericho was in the way, a stronghold. And strongholds get in our way to keep us from getting to the promises of God. My God. But Rahab learned to speak the heart of God. When you look at the text, especially in verse 9, it starts talking about what she said in verse 9. Isn't that what it says? And said to the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land, that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. My God. Now, and what she says, I know the Lord is going to give you the land. She's not an Israelite. She was not in the camp of the Israelite. She was not around the fire of the Israelite. While the Israelites were worshiping God over in their tent, she was in Jericho doing her job. My God. She was a working girl. And so, but somehow she took enough time to seek God. And what I love about Rahab, that even in a wicked place, she learned to hear the heart of God. My God. She didn't learn to hear the heart of God in the church. She didn't learn to hear it in the temple. She didn't even learn to hear it in the camp of the Israelite. But in the wicked city of Jericho, she learned to hear the heart of God. And so if you want to hear God, you can find God anywhere. You can hear his heart no matter. I don't care what your situation is. I don't care what your lifestyle is like. I don't care what your surroundings are like. If you seek God, God said you will find me. My God. If you open up your heart to him, he'll open up his to you. My God. If you knock on his door, God an answer. And his door can be found anywhere. And that's what I love about God. Sometimes we think we can't find God if we're not in the church. And God has shown us right now with this virus. We can't go into the church, but we still having church. Yeah. And the Holy Spirit showing up over here at the house. My God. And so I want us to understand a lot of these things that we say you got to be here to find God and you got to do this to find God. If you seek him, amen. If you seek him, he'll show up. He just wants somebody that's real. And so she learned to seek God. Her house was on the wall. And so what happened is she heard about what was taking place. She said she heard how she gave the testimony. Listen at verse 10. She says, for we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea. She had the testimony of the Red Sea. My Lord. We heard about y'all at the Red Sea, how God handled Egypt and how he handles Pharaoh's army. We've heard about y'all even before you got here. And even those two kings you dealt with as soon as you got here, we've heard about you. And see, God would get the word out there. And the word had gone out before they got there. The word had gone that God, people were coming through. My Lord. If you're moving with God, he'll send a word before you and let the devil know you about to move out of the way, because the children of God are coming through. My God. And so she began to testify to them. But I love the way she spoke and said, I know what it is. She declared the sovereignty of God in the earth and heaven. It was an amazing thing that she was testifying and declaring the sovereignty of God. You would think she wouldn't even know God. And it let us know that you can find God and God will teach you who he is. She was not one of the Israelite priests, one of the Israelite strong men. She was a prostitute in Jericho, but she declared that she said, I know your God is the sovereign God of heaven and earth. My God, have mercy. Mm. And then not only that, not only did she declare the sovereignty of God, she spoke prophetically to them. She said, I know the Lord is going to give you the land. She spoke it before them, my God. She prophesied, my God. She done went from being a harlot to being a prophetess. Ooh, Jesus. She prophesied about what God is going to do. My God, have mercy. And so, and then she provided a covering for the servants of God. For when the spies came, they went to her house. And when they went to her house, and sometimes God leads you in some strange places, but God is up to some, and it ain't up to foolishness. And so don't get it twisted. God don't send you to a strange place to join in with what folk are doing. God sends you to make a difference. And so he sent them there because there was something in the house that God saw a value and wanted to save. And see, God will look down in your life, no matter how ragged it is, how much it's in discord, and God will see something in you, and God says, I can do something with this person. Now, their life is not where it needs to be, but I can do something with them. I can look down and I see old Saul, but I can make some out of Saul. I can turn him to Paul, my Lord. Yeah, he out there putting my children in jail and having them killed, but I can do something with him. He looked down and he said, I see old Peter. He cussing sailor. He cuss everybody out in the boat. Yeah. And you know, watch him. Yeah. But I can do something with him. And not only will he do that, he'll fight in a minute, in a New York minute. You push him, you got to fight on your hand. But I can do something with him. And so God looked down there and saw these folk and said that I can do something with them. He even looked down and he saw Abraham. And Abraham, he got a habit of lying, but I can still do something with him. And not only that, he looked down there and he saw Mark Crutcher. Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, he in the club, partying and having a good time, but I can do something with him. I just got to bring him on up out of there and bring him closer to me. Because I got to send him down to Orlando. There's a church down there called Mount Olive that's going to be looking for a pastor one day. My Lord. So I got to get him up out of here now, and I got to get him ready so he can go there when I need him to go. And that's how God is. God see what we gonna be before we ever get there. God. And that's why we love to say, I'm glad he looked beyond my faults and he saw all of my needs. Because folk like to look at our faults and they don't want to look at anything else. But God looked beyond those faults and he see our needs. Not only does he do that, but God see not what just what we are. He see what we can be in him. So he looked down in Jericho and he saw a harlot, but he saw something more than a harlot. He saw what she could be in God, my God. And so he intervened in her life. He sent the servants to her house, to the harlot's house, because he said, I'm going to do something in the harlot's house. I'm going to bless the harlot's house. I'm about to save some folk in the harlot house. My God. I know they're going trying to make it rain, but I got something else in mind. I'm going to let them know I'm the rainmaker. I'm the one that make it rain. Woo, Jesus. And so this thing is, and this is a lesson of faith. And it says, by faith, she obtained a good testimony. Woo, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encircled for 7 days. By faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe when she had received the spies with peace. My God. So she learned to speak the heart of God. And if we want to turn it around in our lives, we must learn to speak the heart of God. But then she also served the kingdom of God. When we start speaking the heart of God, then we have to switch our service. Her service was the service men, the pleasure men. But then she began to switch her service, my God, and began to serve an almighty God. And so some things begin to happen. Now, listen what happened in verse 15. It says, then she let them down by a rope through the window of her house. She had already hid them. Now she let them down from a house that was on the city wall. And notice this, God had her in the right place. Her house was at the wall. If she'd have been in the middle of Jericho, it wouldn't have done no good, because she needed to be able to let them out of the city. So her house was on the wall. See, God will place you in a strategic place even before you know what's going on, my Lord. And no telling how long she had been there. But God had her put there because he knew when he came by, he was about to do something in that place. And so God will set us in place for something he's going to do later on. My God. And so, and she let down, she let them down by a rope through the window. For her house was on the city wall. She dwelt on the wall. And she said to them, go to the mountain, lest the pursuers meet you. Hide there 3 days until the pursuers have returned. Afterwards, you may go your way. My God. And see, not only did she hid them and covered them with flax. And then when everybody was gone and it was dark, she let them down by a rope over the wall. And she told them to go to the mountain and stay 3 days. She's even prophetic, 3 days, one for the Father, one for the Son, and one for the Holy Spirit. My God. And so she said, three days, and the pursuers will be out of the way. Then you can be able to go. So again, she's speaking prophetically into the lives of the ones, the servants of God. The servants of God came to spy the land. They come to see what was in the land. They come to see what were the conditions in the land. And here she was telling them how to escape death and capture. And so what she did was she cut ungodly soul ties with the enemy. And so, and that's what we have to do, because in our lives of being bad, we develop ungodly soul ties. She began to cut away from the folk in Jericho. And when the people in Jericho came to talk to her, she said, yeah, the men came, but I ain't know who they were. Yeah, I ain't know who they were. And they left out by the time it got dark. And I don't know where they went. Now, she was saying this, but all the time they're on the top of her house. My God. And so if you're gonna tell one for the Lord. Uh-huh. And so she, yeah, if you're gonna tell one for the Lord. She's saving their lives. And so now she's switched out. And rather than go and tell the folk, yeah, the men right up there. Now watch this. She know they're coming to spy the land, and they finna take over the whole land. And so she's willing to say, no, I'm going with God. Because I know what God is about to do. She tell them, I don't know where they went. She said, and she told them, matter of fact, if you go and pursue them, you can catch up with them. My God. And so she got them out of the way so that the servants can get away. Ooh. Had a prostitute working for the kingdom of God. And so you got to remember, if you're going to work for God, you got to cut your ungodly soul ties. But those things hinder the relationship, and they hinder the service of the Lord. And so she hid the spies in her house and let them over the walls. And she allied herself with the kingdom of God. And so, and that's what we have to do, is we have to join the right kingdom. You might have been in the wrong kingdom, but it ain't too late to join the right kingdom. And you have to learn when it's time to switch sides. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But hadn't all of us served the devil enough in our lives? If we haven't, all of us ought to be switched over by now. Your faith is shown through your works of righteousness. And I want you to understand, if you got faith in God, they have to be seen. If nobody ever see your faith, then you may not have the faith that you think you have. Because our faith is demonstrated in our acts of righteousness and what we do. And so the next thing I want to say is that she, not only did she speak the heart of God, not only did she serve the kingdom, but she saved her family. And that's what you have to learn to do, to save your family. while folk are being bad girls and boys, our families are suffering. And you have to learn to save your family. And we do some stuff because we big enough to do it. But it costs somebody something. Somebody got, we dancing to the music, but somebody got to pay the piper. And sometimes it's our children and our grandchildren and our great-grand, and the Bible said even to the fourth generation. And so at some point we have to learn to save the folk around us. And we have to just stop looking out for us and looking out for our own selfish desires. We're lifting out for our own lustful desires. And we begin to work for the kingdom and to save our family. Because God, this whole thing is about family. And so, and I'm glad she might have been a prostitute, but she wasn't a selfish prostitute. She might have been a prostitute, but she had love for family. My God. And so what, to save the family, she made a deal with the kingdom of God. And she had held them to a vow. Listen at what the word said, verse 17. Let me go up some. And she says, 12. Now therefore I beg you, swear to me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness, that you also will show kindness to my father's house, and give me a true token, and spare my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all that they have, and deliver our lives from death. My God. Yeah, my whole father's house. And if you would save the house, and so she made a deal with them, with the servants of God, that her family would be saved. And so, and she decided this, and watch what they told her so now. They told her in verse 17, the men said unto her, we will be blameless of the oath of yours which you have made us swear, unless when we come into the land, you bind this line of scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down. And unless you bring your father, your mother, your brothers, and all your father's household into your own house, my Lord. And it shall be whoever goes outside the doors of your house into the streets, his blood shall be on his own head, and we will be guiltless. And whosoever is with you in the house, his blood shall be on our head, on our head, if a hand is laid on him. Now watch this. And what they told her, if you want your family saved, you got to bring them all in the house. So now the prostitute house becomes the sanctuary. My God. They find sanctuary in the prostitute house. And so, and he tells them, now she got to be an evangelist. You got to bring them in the house. Can you, now you got to bring them in the house. They're out the house in a wicked place. They're living out there in a wicked world, but you got to bring them in the house. Not any house, but this house, your house. Because your house, I'm just finna make it the sanctuary in Jericho. Woo, God Almighty. Woo, ain't God so? Now, I'm going to turn the prostitute house, it's going to become the church. Oh, God. And when he tell them, if you want them to be saved, you got to bring them in. And if we're going to save our families, we got to bring them into the house of God, in relationship with God. We can't let them stay out there in their foolishness. We can't let them stay out there in their wrongness. We've got to talk to them, encourage them, and get them in relationship with God. And so I told him, and so now, and he said, you tell them that they're going to have to come in your house, because this, your house is where I'm going to bless. Your house, I'm finna make my house, and everything in your house, I'm going to save. It was like when Paul was on the ship, and the folk was about to go on board and get in another ship. Paul told them, unless you stay on board, you won't be able to be saved, because everything on this ship gonna get saved. The ship gonna wreck, but ain't no lives gonna be lost. And so he tell them that. So you get them all, get your dad in here, get your mama in here, bring your brother in here, bring your sister in here, and bring all this stuff in the house, because whatever in the house gonna be blessed, because I'm gonna destroy everything else. And God is telling us, if you're not in relationship, you're going down with the world. My Lord. Because everything else going to go down, and everything that's in my house is going to be able to stand. So we got to bring them in the house in relationship. And then he says, they'll tell them they're going to have to stay in the house. They can't go out in the streets and play around. And that's the problem with us so many times, us Christians. We love to go, we love to run in the house, but we want to run out and play a while. We want to run in the house, and then we want to run and play a while. We run in the house on Sunday, and we go play all the rest of the week. And you may see us about 3 weeks later, we run back into the house again. When we get sick, we run to the house. Rev, can you pray for me? Yeah. As soon as we get well, you can't find them. My God. We go to jail. They write you letters. Oh, Rev, I love the Lord. All kind of word from the Lord. Soon they get out of jail, they don't come back. They do like muddy up. They go by the church. Mm-hmm. Yeah, by the church, and they burn rubber on the house of the Lord. And so, but he told them they must remain in the house. Because if they go out, then their blood is going to be on them. Because I'm only going to save what's in the house. Woo, Jesus. And then he tells her this. Take the red cord and let it hang out the window. Did not he tell the Israelites, put the blood on the mantle and on the doorpost? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And when I see the blood, mm-hmm. I'm going to pass by. My Lord, she's prophesying about the blood of Jesus at the prostitute house. Now the red cord, which is a symbol of blood, which is a symbol of salvation, is on the prostitute's house. Not at the temple of Jericho, but at the prostitute's house. That's the power of our God. That God says, if I come into the house, I'm going to clean it up. God Almighty Jesus. You know he turned hell into a church, because all of the saints that was in hell when he died, he brought them up out of there. Good God. And hell ain't been the same since then. Woo, God of Jesus. Woo, can you see the devil? What in the world have come down here now? Ain't never seen nothing like this. I can't hold him down. Ain't got nothing to hold him. I ain't got nothing to make him cry. Ain't got nothing to make him in torment. Ain't got nothing to torment him by. Ain't got nothing to make him feel guilty by. He ain't got no guilt in him. He ain't got no guile in his mouth. He got no hatred in him. Ain't got nothing to hold him here with. And not only can I not hold him, but he leading the other folk out here. They done got a revolt down here in hell. And look like everything about to come up out of here. My God. All of those that I thought I had down here, they gonna take them up out of here with them. They gone with them. Look at the saints. They going marching into Zion. Oh God. When God walk in, he cleans the house. Woo. So she made a deal with God. And so she made the deal. She, and let me tell you what happened. They came in, destroyed Jericho, the walls fell down flat, killed all the people in Jericho, except the folk that was in Rahab's house. The only folk that got saved in Rahab in Jericho was in the prostitute house that become the sanctuary and the place of salvation. Now, and this is what, and here this, when God fix you up and change you, don't go back to being the bad girl. Rahab changed her occupation. She stopped being a prostitute and became a housewife. My God. And here's where it gets even sweeter. She married Sam. She became Salmon. She became a housewife. Now, and here's the funny thing. Salmon was David's great-great-granddaddy, was great-grandfather, my Lord. And so she become the great-grandmother of David the king. She was a prostitute in Jericho. Now she's an Israelite. And not only is she in the group, now you would think that God would hide her and put her in a place where nobody would see her. Because she the prostitute out of Jericho. You would think that she would be obscured and nobody know she there. But God does not eschew what he saved and who he saved. God put her up front. She becomes the great grandmother of David, the king. God Almighty Jesus. Ooh. So you done went from being the prostitute to being a housewife, and now you're the grandmother of the king, of the greatest king that Israel ever had. My God Almighty. The king that God says a man after his own heart. Ooh, God. She the great grandmother of David. Ooh. So see, and that's how God says your past don't stop me from exalting you. Your past don't stop me from using you. Your past don't stop me from lifting you up. Mm. And it doesn't matter to me that folk know what you used to be. I just want them to know what you are now. Mm, God. And if you just remain faithful to what I made you, it don't matter to me what you used to be. As a matter of fact, you become a testimony of how much my love can do and how much my love can change. How I can clean up any life, my God. She now is the great grandmother of the king. She's royalty now. Oh, God Almighty. Woo. Now, and if you think that was enough, then now she's in the bloodline of the Messiah. Lord have mercy. She's in the bloodline of Christ who will save the whole world. How does a prostitute get in the bloodline of Christ? By the same gracious love that put us in there. Ooh, Jesus. Mm. You're the king's great-grandmama, and now you're in the bloodline of Christ. Ooh, Lord have mercy. And so, so that your actions of faith and righteousness will get you in the bloodline. And then watch this. And then while Matthew is writing over in the New Testament, Rahab been dead and gone hundreds of years by now. But God got Matthew got to write a name and got to put it in the genealogy. I'm going to put the bad girl in the book. Hallelujah. Because I'm going to show you I'm that kind of God. I can do it like that. God, I'm going to tell you he's a show out kind of God. He had her, he lifted her up and highlighted her. My God Almighty. Ooh, and Matthew got to go and write the name Rahab. Ooh. And so, right quick, like I told y'all that was talking about more than one. One of the bad girls, the one that in here is Tamar. Tamar was given to Judah's son, one of Judah's son, but Judah's son died because he wasn't right, he was wicked, he died. And she wound up with no husband. And Judah was supposed to give her another son, but he didn't give her another son. So Judah went and played the harlot and dressed up like a harlot. And Judah went in and she got pregnant for Judah and got Perez, who became a part of the bloodline of Christ also. My Lord. Because she did not want to be discarded. And when Judah went back to try to find her, because he had left his cane and his cords there, she had him. Mm. And he realized, and he said, you've been more righteous than me. Because she got a son and got her inheritance, and that son got in the bloodline. So you got Tamar, who played the harlot, the prostitute. You got Rahab, who was a real professional prostitute. See, Tamar got to be a bad girl out of desperation because she knew if she didn't have a child, she would be a discarded woman all her life, couldn't own no property, couldn't do anything. So out of desperation, she became a bad girl. Rahab became a bad girl by choice of lifestyle. She chose to be a prostitute. Don't know how she got there, but that's what she did. And then Ruth was the other one that's in the bloodline. Ruth was an idolater from Moab, from the land of Moab. They worship idols. But Ruth became the mother of Obed, who became, and Obed was Jesse's daddy. And Jesse was David's daddy. My God. She got in the bloodline. and then the family of the king. Then the Moabite, come out of Moab and come back, and so she becomes now a Boaz wife and gets in the bloodline as well. And she was a bad girl by cultural association, because the Moabites were idolaters. They were not considered to be with the Israelites. But she switched out, and that's why, remember, she told Naomi, she said, your God gonna be my God. And where you dwell, I'ma dwell. And where you die, that's where I'ma die. And so God put her in the bloodline. The fourth bad girl was Bathsheba. Bathsheba was the one that got there by lustful moments. And she liked the way the king looked. And when the king sent for her, she didn't hesitate to come. Yeah. And ladies, don't try to fool yourself, talking about she had to go, she didn't have no choice. Yes, she did have a choice, because the king wasn't her husband. As a matter of fact, he wasn't supposed to be calling for nobody. He was supposed to be at war. And so, but she was caught up in there. And as a matter of fact, she knew David could see her in her house when she started taking that bath. Mm-hmm. So her own lust for nothing. And that's the thing, you got to be real though. Because if you're going to go good, you can't go good acting phony. You got to be getting real with your stuff. And you got to realize where your weaknesses are. Because until you can face your weaknesses, you can't overcome them. And the problem with us, we keep trying to hide our weaknesses. And what we're doing is giving the devil more strength over us. Because what we hide in the darkness, the light of God can't shine on it. But when you begin to tell yourself where your weaknesses are, I got a weakness for this and weakness for that. You got to get real with you, and then God can make a difference in your life. And so Bathsheba was an adulterer and the wife of Uriah. But she became Solomon's mother. My Lord. Now y'all don't throw no eggs and don't throw no tomatoes at me. Cause the last one I'm gonna bad girl is Mary, Jesus' mama. Yeah, y'all ready to throw your eggs. He done messed up now. She got to be a bad girl by doing what was right. She, as a young girl, was brought up in the temple. And because she didn't have a husband, she had a bad reputation. When she got pregnant with Jesus, the word was that she done went out there and committed fornication and got a child and just was fooling Joseph. Even Joseph was about to leave her at first, and the angel had to talk with him. She had a bad reputation for doing what God said. God told her, I need you to have this child, and you ain't got no man involved into the process. But the folk didn't believe that God was in it. And so she had the reputation of having an illegitimate child. And this stuff followed Jesus through a lot of his life. But she knew what she did was not wrong, because she was obedient to the Lord. Sometimes God will require some of you that make it look like you have done wrong. And the reputation sometimes get tainted, but you can't stop from doing what God will because folk of what they're going to say. Because the truth of the matter is they're going to talk about you anyway. Yeah, and that's the truth. And so, but what happened is she birthed the Messiah of the world. My Lord, what a mother that is. And I thank God that she was. And so you got some other women, the Canaanite woman who had the possessed child, but had enough faith to say, if I have to be your dog, let me be your dog, but I just need a crumb from your table. Or the Samaritan woman that was at the well who had five men. She was going through men like water. She like what they call her, that college lady, what Elizabeth Collins? Liz Taylor. Liz Taylor, that's her name. The one that says, yeah, Liz, they say Liz told him, say, well, I promise you one thing, I won't keep you long. And so, but she became a servant of the Lord, and led the men to Jesus. And then the other one was the woman with the alabaster box, Mary, the sister of Lazarus, who anointed his body. And the folk talked about Judah wanting to know why you didn't sell all that. Yeah, because he was a treasure. Any questions from anybody? Anybody got any question? And I want you to know, I don't care how bad girl you've been, you can be a good girl with the Lord. How can we identify the strongholds in our life? Read the word, the Bible will tell you. Everything that we do, the Bible has a word for it, and believe the word. And if you're doing something that the word say you shouldn't do, and then you know that's a stronghold. It becomes strong because you know better, but you're still doing it. And those things that mess up our relationship with God, those things that mess up our relationship with the people that God put in our lives, and those things that mess up relationships in our family, those are strongholds that the enemy got. And anything that you know wrong that you can't turn loose, that's a stronghold. You know it's wrong, but you still ain't letting it go, that's a stronghold. It's causing problems in your marriage, that's a stronghold. It's causing a problem with your family, that's a stronghold. You got to hide it from everybody, that's a stronghold. Yeah, you can't even admit it to yourself. That's a stronghold. Yeah. And so it come in all kind of ways. So some folk is drinking, some folk is sex, some folk is money, some folk is power, some folk is attention, some people it's a mixture of. So those are strongholds and all of them. And I want you to understand they have an idolatrous nature to it. Because if you know God is not pleased with it and you're still doing it, then you're putting that before God. Is there such a thing as crazy faith? Yeah. Because some faith just don't make sense. And some of the things that God will tell you to do gonna sound crazy to the world. It's crazy to the world, but it's all right with God. Yeah. Sometimes he tell you, leave your job. Oh, Lord, you know you got to pay your bills. But God say, leave it. Yeah. Sometimes he tell you, go to a place, told Abraham, leave your whole country and go be a stranger in the land that you don't even know nothing about. Sometimes it sounds crazy. That way Jesus was, that thing of going to the cross, Jesus said, I don't want to do this yet. You must have another way, Father. This year, you didn't ask me to do it. I've done everything you told me to do, but I don't want to do this one. But he said, but not my will, but thine be done. And sometimes the stuff God tell you just don't make sense. Yeah. Tell them lame man, take up your bed and walk. Well, I can't walk. So how will you get up to take up my bed? Yeah. But that way you just got to be obedient. He go down there to the man dead for 4 days, and he tell him to open up the tomb. Yeah, that sound crazy. They told him, said, but he's thinking now, Jesus. You don't wait it too late. You don't wait it too late. No. You need to leave him alone. Even the disciple told him, why didn't you come while he was still living? You wait till he died, then tomorrow we're going to go see him. That sounded crazy. It don't make sense. But the things of God don't make sense to the world. And you got to understand this. Jesus, some of his family thought he was crazy. It's in the scripture. They thought he had lost his mind. And so some of what you're doing that, yeah, when the Lord called me, when I heard the call to preach, my brothers called my mom and told him, said, you better come get your son. He done lost his mind. Negro done gone crazy. And mama said, well, what is he doing? So he's sitting in his room praying, walking around this big old Bible, calling on Jesus. And mama said, well, if he praying, leave him alone. Hallelujah. But there's no saying, you ought to be crazy like a fox. Crazy enough to be with the Lord. Yes, faith sometimes, it sounds crazy, it don't make sense, but it's real. And when you trust God, God will just make it come out all right. Why are relationships so important? Woo, that's a good one. Well, because God is a God of relationship, and he don't do anything outside of relationship. Hear this to me. Anything you got to get outside of a righteous relationship is not of God. is straight from the devil, because God works everything through relationship. That's why he built Israel out of a family, out of Abraham's family, out of relationship. And he told Abraham, he says, I'm going to save all the families through you. That's why he sent his son, not one of the angels. He sent somebody in relationship with him. That's why Abraham could save Lot and almost save Sodom and Gomorrah, because he had a relationship with God. And because he had a relationship with God, those who were close to him come under that sound. So it's relationship. Because God, and let me just say to everybody, I want you to understand this. When God was not trying to build a church, that's not what God is about, building church. What God is about, building family. And God made the church to save his family. His family was in trouble, so he made the church to save his family. God is building family. That's why he said, that's why Jesus don't say, when you go to heaven, I got a place for you in my Father's church. He said, no, I go to prepare a place for you in my Father's house. Yeah. And I need you to come on home and be my child, not my member. Yeah. So relationship is everything. And let me say this. That, you know what Rahab? Rahab says, I'll do this, but you got to save my family. She thought about relationship. She could have got out of there by herself, but she said, no, I can't do this by myself. You got the promise to save my family. Now, if she'd have got out and tried to get out of there by herself, she'd have shown she wasn't worthy to leave there. That's why Lot's wife couldn't make it out, because stuff back there was more important than relationship. Wow. Because everything that was in relationship to Lot was able to escape. And the only reason why they didn't escape is because they didn't want to. And so, and because that was stronger than her relationship, she didn't make it out when she was already spared. Wow. Now that's sad. You've been spared and you still don't make it out, because you can't turn it loose. Wow. Relationship is paramount. And so, and our relationship with Christ is what allows God to even see us. Next one is, what is supernatural transformation? Wow. That's when God teach you how to take your naturalness and put it in subjection to his spirit. That's when the liar learned to tell the truth. That's when the cheater learns to be faithful. That's when the whoremonger learn to walk in holiness. Oh God. And yeah, that's when the fighter learn to fight for God and not for the devil. My Jesus. Ooh. That's when the cursor learn how to praise. God in the sanctuary. And so supernatural transformation, when you transform from what the world made you to what God intended for you to be. I said he looked beyond your fault and saw your need. He looked beyond what you are and saw what you could be in him. That's Saul on the Damascus Road. My Lord. And now he done turned to Paul. Woo, Jesus. Supernatural transformation, when God do something, and it affects not only your naturalness, but your spirit as well. And so the two go together. And that's where we ought to walk in there. That's when the drug dealer go, become a righteous preacher. That's when the pimp, my Lord, go to church and start being, could become the evangelist. That's when the hooker leave the pole and go, and now she the usher in the church. My God from Zion. Woo, God. Supernatural transformation. My God. Yeah. And that's when the stripper become the students. Ooh, God, Jesus. That's when the prostitute get in the bloodline of Jesus. Supernatural transformation. Let me thank you tonight for just being a part of the Bible study. I hope I've said something that made a difference in your life. And I'm just trying to remind you that that it don't matter who you are or what you've been, God can make a difference in your life. And if you have not, find out what your calling is and what God is calling you to do and to be. Who would ever thought that a prostitute in Jericho would become the king's great-grandmother? Who would ever thought that Rahab, the prostitute in Jericho, would get in the bloodline of Jesus? My God. Ooh, who would have ever thought? That's why they asked Jesus, can anything good come out of Nazareth? He said, just watch and see. So don't let your past define your future. And don't let your past dictate your legacy. Find out what God created you to be and become that. And when you become it, stay it. Because Rahab never went back to Jericho. my Lord. And remember the song that we play. We don't have the rights to them. We played Shirley Caesar. Thank God for her doing it. Now I want to play one by C.C. Wagner. Just close out listening to a little bit of the Alabaster Box.
And that's Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears.
God bless you now.